telling me, you know, that east is a rising place. It is known as Udaya Disha. So it is a rising place and west is there. I mean, it has been clearly told the people about being Karma Bhumi and Bhoga Bhumi. There are two things. If a person is interested in spiritual enhancement or material prosperity, they must have three requisites. One is Janma, that is being born. And second is Nivasa, migration. Pravasa or Nivasa, that is migration. And third thing is Ashraya, association. If a person wants a spiritual enhancement, either he must be born in the east, or he must be migrated to the east, or he must be associated with the persons or principles of east. And for material prosperity, vice versa. So this is how the people, they have classified it. Some other person is interested in speaking with the mobiles. So this is what we have qualified and classified between east and west. I want to say two defects of west. The one is they are having tools without the purpose. Second, they are very much vehement about attaining the purpose without having proper tools. I want to explain these two things with brevity. The first thing is we have been seeing a lot of colonization, globalization, then global marketing, enhancement of social standards of living, then also science and technology and boosting various other things they are doing. And what is the purpose? These things are the tools are the purpose of life. Science and technology, industrialization or urbanization are the tools for life for some other purpose or the purpose itself. It is not the purpose. Even a very unlettered person or a limitedly knowledgeable person, he won't just defend that it is a purpose. It is a tool for achieving some purpose. So any tool that has no purpose or that is having a purpose but not attaining it, not attaining the purpose but getting into some other adverse effect, all these things are destructive tools in disguise. So basically the purpose is harmony, peace, happiness, expansion of human contact and connectivity. All of these things are the purpose of the so-called tools. We must lead a qualified life. We must lead an enhanced style of life. It must be distributed to various amount of people. It must extend, expand and enhance the levels of people. So this is the purpose. So it has not been achieved at all and we are seeing adverse effects. That is the first failure of Western knowledge and practice. The second thing is they want purpose, that is family relation and also good relation between the elders and the youngsters. That is first I have told about the domestic relations of consorts. And second thing, it is between the generations. Third thing, it is between the subjects and the ruler, the ruling system and the subjects. So all of these things formally, they deal with an integral system of a well-developed and well-nourished facility by which a person can live a life of comfort. This is the purpose for which they don't have any tools. What is the greatness of us? We have five greatness, which is very salient, distinct, distinguished and distinguishable from the Western schools of the thought. Number one, it is the school of Ananta, infinity. We are connected always with infinity, so as we are having the perpetual source of inspiration and perennial bestowal of the charge. And we are connected with infinity, number one. And number two, we are based on scriptures and the religions are not based on scriptures. And even they call that as bibliographic sources of scriptures, but they don't have the qualities of apurushayatva, that is originless, nitya nirdosha, eternally blemishless, svatah pramanya, axiomatic, avichinna gurparampara prapta, that which has been procured by uninterrupted disciplinic succession and disciplined succession. So this is the greatness, the pramana, or this spiritual wealth of a scriptural bounty is not there with them, number two. And number three, Acharya Sishya Bhava. Acharya is different from a teacher, tutor or thinker or somebody else. We are having a lot of creative thinkers of the West, philosophers of the West, and we are having a lot of think tanks, intellectuals, intelligentsia, innumerable people are available also in the West. They are born out of their intellectual exercises. Nayamatma Pravachanena Labhya Na Medhayana Bahunashrutena. They are having these three tools of Pravachana, Medha and Bahushruti. So these things are about the eternal pursuit of knowledge and eternity made by the self-determined spirit of them by which they have undergone intellectual exercises, not with the lineage of their acharyas and with the Shruti Parampara. By which their knowledge is limited and the adverse effects are not prevented. They could not preclude the adverse effects of their knowledge and the knowledge is incomplete. So these type of think pads, these type of executors, they are very limited in their knowledge as well as in their execution. Because this is intellectual exercise. For us, we are having teacher according to Acharya, what we call as Acharya, now there are lot of English synonyms. If we can look for the synonyms, they are very proximate or they are very resemblant, but they are not resplendent as that of the glory of an Acharya. An Acharya is a person who knows what that is to be known, and also he knows what he knows, and he can make us also know what he knows. And he does what he knows, he also who can instill in that doing capacity what he does. This is the greatest of an Acharya. Such people are Anguli Maya, accountable within your fingers. We have produced Acharyas and they have produced thinkers, intellectuals, other people. They are entirely different. We cannot compare these two people with that for excellence. They are entirely different. So this Acharya Parampara is our greatness. And the fourth thing is Paramapurusha. We are having the ultimate reality of God and we see everything in divinity. Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma Tajjalam is the statement of Upanishad. Everything is coming from God, sustainable by the divinity, and everything is dissolved in the God, so everything is divine. That type of seeing oneness in everything, that type of seeing that the divinity and eternity in all ephemeral structures also, seeing the parasentience in each and every sentient and insentient members of the representative family of the cosmic kingdom, that is our greatness. And fifth thing is our achara, our austerity, penance, celibacy, and all of other practices that will burn all of our sins. And anudaya samshaya viparya vismriti vipulipsa. These are the barriers for getting real wisdom. Anudaya is nescience, viparya is misapprehension, vismriti is oblivion, samshaya is suspicion, vipulipsa is deception and deceiving others. All of these innate natures of deviated form of wisdom or diluted, dilapidated form of wisdom will not occur in a case where a person's jnana wisdom is made radiant, resplendent, brilliant and effulgent with spiritual exercise. These five greatness of us that distinguishes us from the Eastern school of thought and also the Western school of thought, wherein the intellectual exercises are predominant because of lack of two things. One is scriptural lineage, second is spiritual lineage. Any person without a scripture, he is said to be motherless, and any person without an acharya, he is said to be fatherless. So those people, the Western think tanks, they are orphans being totally abdicated, abandoned by the schools of thought of scriptural and spiritual lineage. So whatever they want to get for four things, one is physical solubility, second mental sharpness, third thing intellectual sturdity, fourth thing is spiritual valor, color and glamour. For getting all these benefits, they have to be dependent on some source. Just as if we are affected with something else, we go towards the West out of a mania, and that must be an oriental mania, which is nothing but a real way of understanding the oriental wisdom and greatness, the Indological wealth and treasure. They have to come back here to get these things. Number one, physical solubility. Whatever the medicines that have been invented, they have not understood the two major functions of our human body. Number one, it is activated by functional forces like Pitta, Vata and Shleshma. If the functional forces are not understood and merely going to microbiology, parasitology, archaeology, fungology, immunology, virology and bacteriology, understanding of all of these microbes without understanding your functional forces and the determination, they cannot come to a real solution. It will result in nishpala, viparitapala or alpapala. And that is what we are getting in medicines. But that's why we used to say about doctors, a famous saying, Namastubhyam, Vaidyarada Yamaraja Sahodara, Yamastu Harate Pranan, So Pranan Dharne Vachaya. I worship you, my dear doctor, family doctor. You are the big brother of Yama. Yama just, he loots only our life, but you are taking our life along with our wealth. So, that is the greatness for our school of thought that includes the functional forces of Vada, Pitta and Shleshma. Once I attended a microbiology conference, wherein by an entomologist spoke that there are millions of things that are the microbes in the world, and they are detecting with various other subtlest microscopes and latest other inventions. I told that if you are starting with analyzing the things outside, that will be lakhs in number, millions in number, and you have to spend your life only in analysis, not in medication. But if you understand, instead of the things which are intruding you, if you understand the impact what it makes on your body, then you can come to a conclusion, because those things, microbes are millions in number. But the impacts made inside the body by those microbes, they are very limited to Vata, Pitta and Shleshma. They have to upgrade or degrade only any of these three things. So it is a limited origin, so we can easily read these things. Number two, the intrusion of study of mind and its role on medication. The role of mind and body is known as medication. The mind and spirit is known as